Thank you. Town of Prescott Valley Work Study Session Agenda, September 17th, 2020, call to order. Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilmember Hunt?
Here.
Councilmember Packard?
Present.
Councilmember Schumacher?
Here.
Councilmember Grossman?
Still here.
Councilmember Anderson?
Here.
Vice Mayor Nye?
Present.
Mayor Plagueta?
Present.
We have a quorum, Mayor.
Thank you, ma'am. Move right on. Number 3A, Yavapai County Sheriff's Office. Chief, are you going to do the intro?
Good afternoon, Council. Tonight, a couple months back, I had asked everybody on the council if there were any suggested items of interest from you, and one of them revolved around the jail facility for Yavapai County. So we've asked Yavapai County Sheriff's Department to come here tonight, and I'm going to introduce Captain Jeff Noonan from the Yavapai County Sheriff's Department. He is in charge of the jail facility. He'll give you a brief rundown of what's happening in Yavapai County and possibly what's happening with the new facility as well. So, Captain Jeff Noonan.
Thank you. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Chief. Mr. Mayor, council members, thank you for allowing me to come tonight. I really here to answer any questions that you might have, but to try to kind of give you an idea of what our jail currently looks like in that division. My name is Captain Jeff Noonan. I'm the division commander for the Detention Services Division. It's one of our three divisions in the Sheriff's Office. It's our largest division. Currently, that comprises of two facilities. Our main facility, which is the Camp Verde Detention Facility, which is 644 beds, and then the Prescott Intake Facility, which is really a court holding for the Superior Court, which is about 133 beds. And so right now, we are, with the pandemic and everything else that's going on, we are going through some tough times. I'm happy to say that during this entire pandemic, we've only had two inmates that have contracted COVID, and they actually came to us with COVID before they got here. So all of the quarantine dorms and all of the measures that we've taken have helped us there. But currently, your jail in Yavapai County that the sheriff is mandated to run, of the 644 beds, what a lot of people don't understand is that has an operational capacity of 515, really. So what that means is with classification, we can only house, and we do go over this, but we house anything over 500 to 515 inmates, we're overcrowded. And we have been averaging about 570 inmates for the last 6-7 years. With a peak time of 647 inmates during the summer at times. So we have been overcrowded. We've been in desperate need of a new facility to take off that overcrowding for us. And that's one of the things that we're doing in Prescott. But with our facility in Camp Verde, what we've had to do, and this is really one of the major steps we've taken in 2016, is what we might be able to to decrease that population. So in 2016, we started really working hard for diversion programs. And some of the, one of the handouts I gave you tonight will go in depth on that, but the reach out program that we instituted is a program that we partnered with all of our behavioral health homes, our substance abuse homes, some of our partners within the communities like the veterans, the VA, the US vets, housing and whatnot. And what we've been able to do, and our goal was if we could screen for certain risks of every inmate that comes into our facility and identify what those risks are and connect them to care upon their return to the community with mental health treatment or substance abuse treatment or transitional housing, we might make them more successful and they might not reoffend. And please don't get me wrong, there's certain people in our communities that commit crimes that need to go to prison and certain people that need to never get out of prison because of what they do. Those are not the people that we're talking about. Those serious felony offenders are going to be housed there, taken care of, and gotten through the justice system. What we're really talking about is we wanted to identify those low-level offenders, low-level felonies, possible misdemeanors, and catch them on their first offense. And if we could catch them on their first offense and treat them and get them connected to treatment, we thought we could lower the recidivism. Well, that has happened. And over the last 3 years, since March of 2018 until present, we have been able to cut the recidivism rate in half. So what we noticed in 2015 and 2016 was that our average recidivism rate, those inmates that are committing new criminal offenses, was around 40%, 39 to 40% for those that did not suffer from a mental health issue, and around 80% for those that did suffer from a mental health issue. Well, through the reach out program and the diversion programs, and connecting them to care, we've been able to reduce that recidivism to 16.4%. And so that has decreased our inmate population. We went from 10,500 bookings a year, intakes, down to 8,200 this year. And the only reason we were able to do that is because we've been able to connect people to care, keep them in care, and keep them from reoffending. You know, not victimizing other residents in Yavapai County. So it's been extremely successful. We've also been able to do that through the pre-arrest diversion, which is our mobile crisis care. So if you have an officer on the street that identifies somebody that maybe is disorderly in your library, for instance, and you know he has a mental health issue, you know he probably doesn't deserve, or maybe he deserves to go to jail, but maybe the best place for him is not jail. Maybe the best place for him is in a mental health facility. Well, through mobile crisis, through Spectrum Healthcare, through West Yavapai Guidance Clinic, through Southwest Behavior, they now respond and they take over those instances and we divert them from even going to jail and we get them the treatment. So that has diverted almost 3,000 individuals over the last 3 years to our jail. That has brought our average daily population down from 640 in our peak times to 511 today. I'm still over capacity, I'm still over 500, but it's brought it way down. And so that's what ties into the need for the new Criminal Justice Center. And as you, in your paperwork, the handouts that you can read, you can see that the Board of Supervisors have been working on this for over 20 years. You know, we have had the DOJ in our building telling us time and again, you're overcrowded, you need to do something. You know, at one time we were even threatened to be fined every day unless we built the Verde facility. Well, we're overcrowded again, and so we need to act. And so the Board of Supervisors have done a phenomenal job at recognizing that. They recognize the need to continue with the connections. So really the Criminal Justice Center in Prescott is going to be a co-located facility. It's only going to be 152 beds. You know, that's going to help us take off the overcrowding in our facility, but it's also going to allow us to receive, and this is the big key, because I'm a resident of Prescott Valley, and over on this side of the hill in the Quad City area, we do not enjoy the full-service jail that the Verde Valley enjoys. And what I mean by that is if you, and I don't know how many officers you typically have in the community of Prescott Valley at any one time, but I know Prescott Valley, Prescott, the Sheriff's Office in our communities in Baghdad, Wickenburg, because we have a squad in Wickenburg, Yarnell, Ashford, DPS. If you make an arrest over on this side of the mountain and that subject is too impaired to be booked into the Prescott intake facility or they have any medical condition, that officer has to take them to Camp Verde. And so if you can imagine, if you have officers that are going to a fight, let's say, let's use Whiskey, we'll use Prescott as an example, because nothing bad ever happens here. So on Whiskey Row, if we have officers that go to Whiskey Row and they break up a fight of six individuals fighting, and they have to make an arrest of six individuals, and those individuals are combative, then how many officers is it going to take to take those six individuals to Camp Verde? So if you imagine the length of time it takes to do that investigation, the length of time that it takes to book that individual into jail, the length of time it takes to drive to the Verde, which is an hour each way, and then write the report, you're basically losing a large portion of your resources for their entire shift, and you're taking officers off the street. And so the big thing for me, because I used to be in charge of our patrol division as well, is we have to have a criminal justice center on this side of the mountain that offers our law enforcement the same resources we enjoy in the Verde Valley, which is the intake, the full service intake with medical, you know, and so By building what we have here, it's going to allow us to keep every individual that is arrested on this side of the mountain, because over 60% of all of the criminal cases occur on this side of the mountain, not the Verde Valley. 60%. So those officers are going to be able to book in there, and then our goal is to keep all of those subjects in that facility for the first 2 weeks, which is our EDC point, early disposition court. If we can keep them to early disposition court, then the judge decides whether they stay with us long-term or get out. If they stay with us long-term, they're going to go to the Verde. So that opens up that space for our resources and our community over here. And if you imagine, Yavapai County has grown every year in population 10%. We learned that with the Chin study. Karen Chin came in 2016 and did an independent study for us. And she told us, Yavapai County is growing 10% a year every year. Your jail population is growing 10% a year every year. You better be prepared to do something. In Yavapai County, we're estimating the population of the entire county is about 250,000 right now, or close to it. We only have the ability to house 0.2% of that population in our jail. That is not providing adequate resources to our community to keep our streets safe, in my opinion. The Board of Supervisors recognize that. We recognize the need for the jail. We recognize the need for the co-located facility, which is the courts piece, as well as a connections piece, which is the mental health piece that is also being built there, so we can continue our efforts to reach out and connect inmates getting out to care so they don't reoffend and keep that recidivism rate low in Yavapai County. What we have done here in Yavapai County with the help of the Board of Supervisors, the sheriff, teaming with the board, has developed what's called the Yavapai model. The Yavapai model is being used across the country, and we've won national awards for the criminal justice reform that we've already done. Detroit called us yesterday. The chief of Detroit PD called us yesterday and wants to come see what we're doing with Reach Out. And so it works, but we have to continue. I know there's a lot of people that don't want the jail built, you know, in their community and whatnot. I would argue, and I live over here in Prescott Valley, I want the jail close enough to where our officers can make an arrest and use that resource as quickly as possible and get back into the streets where we need them, especially in this day and age. So that's kind of my argument. And I know I gave you a lot of information. What the nice looking charts in front of you, that's the Reach Out. You can see that we're at the 16.4. But these graphs will give you an indication of all of the risk factors we look for. We not only look for mental health and substance abuse, but we're also looking for, you know, if someone's homeless, can we find them transitional housing? Can we find them transportation and vocational rehab? If we can get them a job, get them transportation, and get them transitional housing, we might make them successful, and they might get to their much-needed care at a behavioral health home. So we have people. I have an entire squad, release coordinators, that do nothing but that every day. And the nice thing about this right now is it's all grant-funded. We've been able to do this. I have $1 million worth of staff that's all grant funded, and we've been able to reduce the recidivism, cut it in half, really. So that's really what we're doing in a nutshell. I could stand up here and talk for hours about the need and what we're doing, but I'd really love to answer any questions if you have it. Yes, ma'am. Yes, Vice Mayor.
Let me introduce myself a little bit. Obviously, you can see my name down there, but I also serve on the Rash Yavapai Guidance Governing Board, and I also serve on the Matt Forest Community Board. And I wanted to ask you about the reentry program that Matt Forest partnered with.
That's right.
Because we are so excited about that, and I just wondered from your end of it.
I absolutely can, because I know I was at a meeting in Sedona with Mary Lee Fowler.
Yeah.
And I was talking in Sedona, and we had some folks that had recently been released from the Department of Corrections, and they were in what was called the Yavapai Reentry Program. And so what it was, the reentry program, is everybody that gets released from the Department of Corrections gets paired, if they wish. Everything that we do is voluntary, you know, unless a judge orders it, and if they violate it, then they get, you know, they're violating their conditions. But the Yavapai Reentry Program, they would get paired with a coach. And that coach was like a mentor to keep them on the right path. And I loved what I heard, so I asked Mayor Lee, I said, well, if we're doing this for the Department of Corrections, why can't we do this for the jail? And she says, well, you know, we've never really thought of that. Because the jail population, unlike Department of Corrections, you know when someone's getting out. The jail is fluid. You never know when someone's going to bond out or be released by a judge. But if we can connect them early in their stay and have that set up, what we've done is through Matt Force and that partnership, we're now doing the exact same thing for the inmates getting out of the jail. And so that coach for Yavapai Reentry can help get them to their meetings, can help get them to their appointments for behavioral health or assessments and what. So it's been tremendous. You know, they actually will come along and they come an intricate part of their family in a lot of ways.
Exactly. One of the points I wanted to make, I'm so glad that you understand the success of it. I'm lucky. I've lived with it for a long time. But I want you to know the coaches sometimes get more out of it. And I don't think that surprises you.
It doesn't, because I have an individual that goes to my church who's a coach.
Yes.
So he tells me the story. But if he didn't go, I wouldn't get to hear those stories. But you're absolutely right. And he's done multiple individuals.
We were very excited when you approached us.
Yeah. Well, it's been great. Thank you.
Councilwoman?
I just wanted to say thank you for all your hard work on this endeavor as well. And I don't know what it takes to run such a facility, but do you have an idea of how many positions will be fulfilled with full-time employment? Because I know this is going to take a lot from feeding the inmates to...
Sure.
Cleaning and processing and
absolutely.
Watching over them and everything. I would have no idea what it would take to
absolutely.
Run a facility.
So I'll give you an idea. Our jail facility right now, the detention center in the Verde as well as our intake, is 252 employees.
Okay.
It's a budget of just over $21 million just for that division. We are currently in the process. We had to wait for the final design of what the Criminal Justice Center in Prescott would be. And so now that we have what's called the 50% plans, but we think that they're pretty close to what the final design is going to be. But even before we hired an architect, the Board of Supervisors, the Sheriff's Office, we hired the National Institute of Corrections to come to Prescott, and we had to go through a week-long class about every step it took to plan for a new facility, to budget for a new facility, to staff for a new facility. And so currently right now we're in that phase. We've locked in some plans. We've always had discussions about the new manpower, the new positions that would come along with that and what it would take. But right now, actually this week, we are working on that staffing analysis on how many post assignments, because the jail, unlike any other entity that we operate with, even patrol, you know, there are mandated assignments that are national standards that you have to have in a jail, and they're called post assignments. So if I have a housing unit, there's a certain amount of individuals that have to be in that housing unit, minimum staffing. And so right now we're doing that. I don't have the final numbers, but we have a good idea of how many new positions we're going to need to ask the board for and what that operational cost is going to be. We've had to look at and speak with Wexford Medical, who is our medical provider, who is amazing, that takes care of all the inmates, you know, get an idea from them what the added cost is going to be for there, the kitchen, the food, because we serve, and people, I always get a kick out of it. People don't realize how many meals we serve a month, but we average 62,000 meals a month in the jail, and they're hot meals. Mm-hmm. And there's a nutritional requirement that comes along with that, so the caloric intake has to be just right. And so all of that has to be considered, and the equipment that comes with that has to be considered. But, you know, with that is the transition to the court piece. We will save the county money by not having to bus the inmates over to Prescott. You see the buses, I have three buses, you know, and you usually see one. There's three that are constantly going. One's going to Phoenix, to DOC, and one's coming over here to the Superior Courthouse in the morning, going back, and another one comes in the afternoon and goes back. You know, the transportation alone, and now we have 26 courts, including Prescott Valley Magistrate, that we take inmates to. Some jurisdictions will force the municipality to have their officers come get the inmate out of jail and take them to the magistrate for misdemeanor court. We don't do that. We take them to all 26 courts in the county. That transportation cost every year is about $2 million. You know, so we think by building this co-located facility where we can have law in motion, the things that happen very quickly, not trials, but law in motion, your evidentiary hearings, your prelims, your EDC, your change of pleas and whatnot, have that at the new co-located facility with two judges. And those inmates will stay right there and there will be no need to transport them. So there's gonna be a big cost savings there. So I know that probably didn't answer your question because you're wanting to know, but yes, there will be new positions which will bring industry to Yavapai County.
Right, and offer employment to quite a few residents as well. So thank you.
And Councilman?
Yeah, I know a few years ago with the Arizona Town Hall that I'm part of, we had the subject that year was criminal justice, and Sheriff Masher and a few others from the jail facility were part of the discussion that we had here at Embry-Riddle. And I'm glad to see how productive it is and how well it's working. So that's very good. But I also see on, you know, social media and other places, like you said, there are people that are resistant to the jail.
Right.
And based on the numbers that you've given us and the information, how do they come up with, I mean, they keep saying that we don't have a need for the jail. The jail is, you know, understaffed and under, I mean, there are, you know, fewer, people there. You know, and I was surprised that the jail is only going to have 152 cells, you know, for 152 people. Will the jail be designed in such a way that it will be easy to add to in the future should they need it?
Yes, sir, it will, and it was designed for that. So the Board of Supervisors in the future will be able to decide whether or not they, if we get to that point, or 20, 30 years from now, if we decide we need more bed space, they'll have two facilities to choose from. So they can add on to the Prescott facility because it will be designed to be expanded upon. There are certain walls that we purposely built so we could add on to that wall and designed that way. Or they can decide to expand in the Verde Jail because the Verde Jail is still gonna be there. It's still gonna be our main housing unit. And I'm just gonna say very plainly, and I don't mind saying this because I've been to a lot of meetings with some of the opposition, it is a false narrative. It is absolutely a false narrative. And I'll say that because I work in the jail every day. And 97% of our inmates are in there for felonies. You hear people say, well, if we just opened up the doors and released everybody on misdemeanor possession of marijuana, the jail would be empty. That could not be farther from the truth. Our biggest classification in Camp Verde is sex offender classification. I have two dorms full of violent sex offenders. You know, I have 40 inmates at any one time that are what we call house alone. They're so violent and they're in there, most of them are in there for murder. I think we get kind of isolated from a lot of things, but they're in there for murder. But I have 40 inmates that are so violent they have to be housed alone, multi-officer, multi-restraint. Those 40 inmates take up 80 beds because there's two beds to a cell. I have an inmate that we put somebody in there with, and we thought that they would have the same classification. And last year, because we put them in there, he slit the guy's throat. Those are the types of people we have in our jail. These are the people that we do not want in our community. The ones, now, I'll say that the ones that are not that do not need to stay in jail are going through the reach-out program and are released. So our biggest booking, our biggest intake is misdemeanors. You know, DUIs, possession, they only stay with us long enough to be processed, fingerprinted, and their pictures taken, the judge sees them, and then they're released. So 97% are in there for felonies or mixed charges, felonies and misdemeanors. Only 3% are there for misdemeanors. And the average length of stay for the misdemeanor population is 5 days. 5 days. We're full, and we're full of the people that need to stay there. The ones that we can get out, we work with the judges. The judges are great, and we get them out, and we get them connected, and we try to get them to not come back. But in a population the size of Yavapai County and how big we are growing, it does not make sense to me to only have a facility that can house operationally 500 inmates. And that's where we are today. So when you hear the narrative that we don't need a jail, we have been overcrowded for, it's been at least 6 years that we've been over capacity. And we've had to do the diversion programs to bring it down from that. Once COVID is over and we start accepting misdemeanors again, misdemeanor arrests, we're going to hit close to 700 inmates for a jail that can only operationally hold 500. So, yeah, I hear the same thing, and I drive down the road, and I hear the narrative on the radio, and I'm like, they certainly didn't get those stats from us.
Yeah. Councilwoman?
Thank you. I really appreciated your presentation. You're really good at it. So I'm glad you're our rep in this county to go out and provide factual information.
Thank you, ma'am.
Is there a website where we can find more information?
Yes, thank you. I almost forgot. So the Board of Supervisors, they had a great idea about a month ago to really trying to get the true narrative out there. And it's yavapaijustice.com. But if you type in Yavapai County Criminal Justice Center, it'll take you to that as well. And that's what I like to tell people is we're not building just a jail in Prescott. It's the Yavapai County Criminal Justice Center. It has two Superior Court divisions, and it has an entire mental health facility, which is a connection center. That mental health, the other big piece that I'm sure Mayor Palguda and Chief Roser could really speak to, one of the biggest problems that we have in Yavapai County is Title 36. And our issues with Title 36, which is the involuntary commitment of those that are a danger to themselves or others. Right now, we contract with Pronghorn Psychiatry here, and they're located in Castle Canyon Mesa. This facility is going to be the Title 36 facility, which is going to be a better place for your officers to bring people, drop them off, and get back on the streets instead of going through all of the screenings and the nonsense that the emergency departments and everything else. It's going to be a one-stop shop for them.
So I heard you say that our officers will go directly to the new facility.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool. So it's www.yavapaijustice.com.
Right.
And then is there a Facebook presence?
I think that if you went to the Yavapai County general Facebook page, you'd find it. But the Yavapai County Sheriff's Office Facebook page, we also have a lot of information on there, which will have links to that informational website.
Again, I appreciate it. I just went through an election. There were some bizarre things. I mean, there was a woman that stood up at some event and said, "Why are you putting it in downtown Prescott?" And we're like, okay, it's really far from downtown Prescott, right. But... Yeah. And the co-location with the other facility out there and the Justice Center and everything is the way everybody else does it everywhere else.
Right.
So
right.
I appreciate that you guys are doing this, and I support it.
Thank you.
Any other questions for the captain? Sir,
yes, Mayor,
always a pleasure. Great job.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Moving on, item 3B, Yavapai County rezoning from RCU 2A. M2-2A, Mr. Parker.
Thank you, Mayor. Council members, there's a whole bunch of material in your packet, one of which was a letter that we responded to, an inquiry that we got from the county regarding a proposal for M2, which is the county's heaviest industrial district, to be located in the areas, a couple of sections north of us as we are here. And we responded that, at least in staff's opinion, the photovoltaic proposed on these sites is probably something that's a suitable application. However, the concern we expressed in that letter to my counterpart in the county, and since then we've talked to the county administrator and was fortunate enough to get Mary's ear before the meeting as well, is that the additional uses that are listed in M2 are onerous at best at this location, and we believe that they should be eliminated from any future consideration. I only bring this to your attention because our letter at this point has fallen on deaf ears. And October, first part of October, the county's Planning and Zoning Commission will be hearing the application. We intend to express, hopefully on your behalf as well, concern about the proposal, which would carry with it, from our understanding, if the uses are not excluded, all of these uses that are permitted as a matter of right in the M2 use district. Other materials in your packet includes a rough site plan and so forth. But several of these things, freight yards, things like that with open storage, we believe would be not proper within that use district. As part of your briefing, it's also pointed out that the state law gives municipalities some authority for extraterritorial planning, which we have done. And we have an area within the town of Prescott Valley that includes a annexation strip, which was evident on the previous slide, which shows that clearly within that annexation strip and based on our town's general plan, we have defined the uses that we believe are suitable within those areas. Because of the general plan's focus of 2025, we have identified this area as being undesignated, meaning we don't anticipate future growth and development in this area because there is ample zoning and land use within areas defined in tiers 1 and 2 within the general plan to accommodate the growth of the community until 2025. So as part of state law, it'll be incumbent upon Yavapai County, should they forward this to the Board of Supervisors, that they define for the town why our designations within the town's general plan are somehow in error. And that will be, I think, a tall order for them to demonstrate. We will appear to both the Planning and Zoning Commission and Board of Supervisors, but we want to make you fully aware so that in the case that you have opportunity to interact with board members that you communicate concern, I think rightly so, to this proposed application. Again, we as staff don't oppose photovoltaics. We think that's a reasonable use. It's not necessarily onerous to the view. We have them all over town. And they're not at high stature. They're not typically way off the ground. So we believe that the proposed use as presented, if it were confined to that use, would be suitable. But other uses that are included in the district should be inappropriate in that location. With that, I would respond to questions you may have.
Richard, I just think it's certainly a concern if the applicant's going to try to come in with the photo farm or the solar farm, and then at some point later on down the road then can turn it into an industrial park, which could happen, correct?
I would point to the Grapevine Industrial Park, which came as a result of zoning that was in place in Yavapai County to accommodate a junkyard, which was an M1 use district. When the junkyard went away, it started getting cut into smaller pieces, and it created a development that had no infrastructure. It's known as the Grapevine Industrial Park because how did you find out about it? I heard about it through the grapevine. Somebody was selling a piece of property. As a result of that, Yavapai County, just after I left there, created a unsubdivided land filing to be able to deal with the structure of easements and so forth and not properly prepared roads within the Grapevine Industrial Park. The town serves a portion of that with water. through agreements, and has annexed a portion of it as well, where the trust plant is, as an example. But the remainder of that is county, and I dare say that we could do a better job using our ordinances and regulations to make sure that infrastructure exists to be able to support that thing. And I would suggest that out in the middle of nowhere, out by the fairgrounds, is an inappropriate place to put industrial zoning to attract that kind of activity.
Councilman.
So, Richard, I like this letter, and I'm where you have item one and item three, we kind of talked about this before the meeting, where they could zone it M2-2A heavy industrial if they want, but they can restrict it only to a solar project and
correct,
not allow the other uses.
Correct.
And my concern, I guess, and my hope is that the county does what we do and extends the notices so that the Mingus folks will be able to know about the meetings that are coming up, Mingus West. Because it looks, they're not that close, but, you know, heavy industrial could impact them.
They don't have the same notice requirements. I'll make that suggestion.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Councilman.
Yeah, well, based on the discussion I've just heard here tonight, this sounds like a giant bait and switch. But my question is, if they're going to be building a large solar farm there, what are they going to be connecting it to?
There's a couple of high tension power grid that goes right through the middle of it.
Vice Mayor.
Mr. Mayor.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So, Richard, in a nutshell, there's an easy solution. It's just a question of getting the directive from the County Board of Supervisors to their staff to go ahead and entertain a different approach to that. We're not opposed to the solar farm. We're just concerned about what could happen over the long term.
And being very familiar with county ordinances and how they work,
yep,
I've suggested some solutions that will satisfy our concern.
Very good.
Thank you. Vice Mayor.
Bluntly put, we need all of us to play nice in our sandbox. This isn't nice.
Well,
but there are solutions, and we all have to sit down and be rational and reasonable, and I'm going to be utterly crushed if that isn't the case on the part of the county.
And we fully expect their cooperation, and we'll seek that, but if they don't, we're going to take a different approach. We're going to,
yes,
start rattling some chains.
Yes.
Councilwoman?
I did have one quick question. Can you go back to the list that was right before that as well?
Sure.
On the right-hand side, you had material in dead storage yards. Could you kind of give me an idea of what that includes?
Oh, an ADOT road yard would be very similar to that, where you have large piles of material, dead storage or large junk yards, things like that.
But it's not people-based or anything, correct, or animal-based?
Well, you can
it's
do just cemeteries in M2 as well.
That's what I was wondering. It could be like cemetery.
Which is not as onerous as outside storage.
Okay, and then same with like the animal treating and slaughtering that could possibly someday happen, right? I'm just trying to figure out like what all the meanings truly are, so.
Worst case scenario is the county's M2 use district.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Anything else for Mr. Parker? If not, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Norm, I believe you're up. Proposed NAZ Sons Roadway name change presentation.
Yeah, Mayor, Council, this next item is about the Northern Arizona Sons Roadway name change. I brought this to you about a month ago to get started and get your input. There's been, as we talked about here a month ago, lots of public interest in getting that name changed out there. Northern Arizona Suns have left the arena. And so there's the subject road, as you've seen before, that little stretch of road there between Glassford and Main Street, you know, immediately adjacent to the event center. And that's what caused attention. But what we did do, we worked with our media department, Heidi and Latoya, and put something in our page 4 of our September Town News to alert the public of the ability to put their input in on what they would like or the particular name changes. So you see the little article there on page 4 talks about the desire to change the name and the particular choices there are. So my last slide just shows bigger there so we can see is this is the 5 options that have been presented for voting for the public to vote. As you can see there, the 5 Entertainment Way, August Avenue, Liberty Lane, Arena Boulevard, and Veterans Way. So that's out for public voting. And as you can see there, staff has made a recommendation of voting deadline be October 1st. To tally the votes then, that'd be about a month's time. So going back to the article there in the September Town News, you can see there's online capability through a SurveyMonkey capability, you know, smartphone, the QR code scanning, or if you desire, you can just do it the old-fashioned way and just post to mail it. So our media department will take those particular requests and tally those requests. So tonight, I just wanted to give you an update of what's in play and the closing date of October 1st for the voting. And eventually, we'll work in Public Works to make the sign. And then there is a process through Richards Group, through Community Development, to pass a resolution and have time periods in order to put that into play. Because it is an official thing for, you know, 911 and your addressing and the like. So this part will take place October, and then we'll bring it back for a resolution later on, probably November.
And Norm, if I could, what are the top 2 vote-getters to date?
I talked with Heidi, and to date, the 2 most popular is Arena Boulevard and Veterans Way. And of the voting, they each had around the neighborhood of 175 votes, and the other first 3 were very much far behind, according to our media department.
Councilman, you have something?
Yeah, I'm just curious what it takes in this town to be called a boulevard. Now, we got 200 feet of blacktop, and we're going to consider calling it a boulevard.
So and that's been a suggestion.
I mean,
so.
way or street or something seems more appropriate than boulevard.
Just a comment.
Broken dreams, Councilman, broken dreams.
Honestly.
Yeah, we already got beat up about Scoot Boulevard.
Awesome. Norm, anything else for Mr. Davis? Just want to make sure it's clear that just because the voting's still open, that this could,
voting's
easily,
still open,
this could
so
easily sway anyway right here.
Use one of those particular or media capabilities and make your vote.
And I think it's important that the citizens really enjoy it. It's something that to get their voice heard, and it's important. So thank you, sir. That being said, moving on to item 3D, Street Maintenance Enforcement Program presentation.
Mayor, Council, this next one is our pavement enhancement, as you see put up there. You may recall that I had quite an extensive presentation July 16th, work study. We talked about our pavement maintenance program, gave you more detail of each one of the particular maintenance treatments we're able to do to pavements, you know, depending on the age of the pavement and where it's at and the like. So as you can see, there's some of our maintenance treatments there. I'm real proud of the one there in the lower left corner that the edge patching we're doing in the core of the town. I'm going to talk mostly about that one tonight. Just so we don't leave it, you can see there the one in the lower right-hand corner is, you know, crack seal maintenance on some of the newer roadways when they're not quite as fatigued. You can get by with crack seal, but I always like to show our hot patch trailer there that we tow around. We're actually able to keep mix hot, and we can do a much better job with the permanent patching with that trailer. So that wraps it up together. And then, of course, I always like to show the crowning jewel of when we put the chip seal on, what we do to the pavement to get it to a better service level standard and get that friction course, and we'd like to have a particular program there. So real proud of the fact that in council, and I'm looking at a few of the sitting council people that we talked about that back in January 16 made a decision and were courageous enough to say we need to invest more in our pavements. We put the half cent maintenance tax into place in January of 16, As you can see, we're 5 years later, and we've made lots and lots of progress. I talked about that in July, that we basically invested $9 million, and I wanted to go in a little more detail on specifically some of the pavement enhancement we've done in the core of the town. The old pavements have been around for a much longer time. So as you can see, we've got those years crossed off. On purpose, we draw a line through them to show 5 years down and a great investment made. So as Deanna put that in just to jazz me up a little bit, but part of the software. I always like to point out our current map here. This is very easy to read, I think, and understandable for our residents, that if you pull this up, of course, it's on the Public Works webpage, but what it does show is the last time we maintained a pavement. So this is our ability to show, hey, last ones in line get to be shown attention. So we do move around all the areas of town, but you can see this is most current. One thing I did want to show, you know, the we're still at basically a 10-year program before we hit some pavements, but I want to go into that a little more detail about the investment we made, why we're at where we're here today, and the investment made with the input of council as we've gone the last 5 years. One thing I did want to point on the map, as you can see, you know, a good example of that, this year's chip seal program is the red, as you can see, for the current year. But you can see, why is it red in the newer subdivisions? Well, it's pretty simple. Growth pays for growth. They have to actually build those roadways and get them to that acceptance standard. So that includes a good pavement structure in addition to the chip seal. So as you can see, those newer phases of Jasper and Granville, as you can see over there, those newer phases, that's why they're red. We did lots of pavement maintenance, not only paid for with public dollars, but in addition to the development community having significant lane miles added to our infrastructure in the form of chip seal. So that lets us know, yes, this summer is when that chip seal was maintained. So here, in the future, we know that we need to show that some attention, and that's part of our guideline. I do like to show with pride the Valley Road, as you can see listed there. In fact, the next slide will point that out. The Valley Road pavement rehab, that wasn't particularly, well, a chip seal. Remember, that was 3 miles of road, and it actually got in pretty poor shape with other priorities we had throughout the town. The nice thing that we can report tonight as staff is 5 years later, we've made a big investment. Our major arterials are lots more roads, and higher priority streets have been addressed, but this one, not a big traffic count, but we're happy to say we did a did an evaluation of a good maintenance treatment there, and it is a much better roadway in today's standard, Councilman Anderson, so we're real proud of that. So actually, I had to do a pavement rehab down by the treatment plant, but yes, we were happy as staff that we were able to perform that maintenance and much better service level standard for the traveling public. Wanted to show this map, showed you the 5 years that we've clipped off. Each year, as we've talked about, we had a $2 million invested in our pavements. We as staff made recommendations, whether that was a chip seal, crack seal, in addition to the what I call heavy maintenance, the edge patching, which I'm going to go to in the next slide. But indicative, every year, this is this current year's program, council may recall. So this is on our webpage. But you can see we do a combination of chip seal in addition to the heavy edge patching in the core of the town. We've done that every year for the last 5 years. So as you can see in the corner there, this year due to COVID, we were a little concerned about revenue. So we did cut the program back to $1.25 million. But our current budget does allow capacity for the $2 million. But we want to do a checkpoint and be safe. So we still have plenty of budget here left, and we can certainly do more per council's direction when we meet here at a retreat to see if there's sufficient revenues to continue on with investment in our pavements. So that was this year's program, and this year especially we cut it back a little bit to deliver and stop short and play it safe to make sure we have adequate revenues. This next slide is one we're real proud of, in that as you can see up in the corner, we showed you the 5 years of the pre-chip maintenance. And what we wanted to show you, we talked about each year we either did chip seal and or heavy maintenance in some of the core of the town to get that original historic pavement width there, and tune up the oldest pavements in town. With pride and I, as you can see, the five different colors show that we are going to be done, with the orange color being this current year. We do have a local Earth Resources is under contract to perform our last bit of the pre-chip heavy maintenance in the Lynx Lake Estates area, in addition to Northridge Park and a little portion of Castle Canyon Mesa. So we could make it all orange and show you, but what this really depicts well is the investment made each year of just heavy maintenance on some of the core of the town, which is old pavement. So if you look in the legend up on top, you can see year one there, we spent $500,000, and $600,000 the second year. Third year, turned out we did a lot less chip seal because we needed to catch up on that heavy maintenance. So you can see we actually had, that was a big year. That was $1.3 million. So as you can see, anywhere from $500,000 to $1 million a year went into that heavy maintenance that we talked about to get that edge back. So proud to report tonight, give us another month. Every road has just about to the, a good, about the same service level standard. The court of the town has been addressed. And those particular colors show each year and the investment made throughout. And as we pointed out, the reason that we do some of the other ones last is because they were the ones that were the, you know, the one that were longest in maintenance got done first. So a big investment, five-year program of basically $2 million a year. This is where we're at. Our service level standard is much better. Did want to point out, you might ask, I don't wear hats usually with my jacket, but we just got hats in Public Works and just a little badge of honor on the past is year five is just the streets guys wear these with pride because they've been heavily involved with leading this particular program. So that's just a little badge on the side. Call attention to the hard work they've done. Moving on to talk a little more. We've talked about that each year has a different color, and you know we've been, you know, basically 5 years invested $9-10 million, or ultimately $10 million. Where are we at? Well, all that heavy maintenance we did, you saw, if I can back up, I don't know if I made that particular comment, but you can see aggregately we've spent $3.8 million, close to $4 million of just getting the pavement back to a better service level standard. So our maintenance suffers of the surface course of the chip seal when we have to invest in the pavement. But it's staff's recommendation. That's the best way to maintain our payments to that best service level standard. Let's go back. So we're looking at now, you can see, well, we're still on a 10-year cycle. Some of the brown areas can be up to 10 years. What we'd like to show is we always like to run our numbers ahead of time to know if we have an infusion of money or, you know, how close can we get. The next slide really kind of sums it up. You can see those areas. Those are 4 years of areas. And you can see it's maybe a little difficult to see at the scale there, but basically each one of those years represents about $400,000 worth of area. So as I pointed out before, when we finished that, basically the Lynx Creek Estates, each side of Sunset Lane, that we're done with that investment that we've been investing nearly $500,000 to $1 million a year, we can put it all into chip seal and service maintenance or some other heavy maintenance somewhere. So you can see here that you know, basically when we get $2 million, we can actually clip off 4 years because each one of those areas represents about a $400,000 investment. So what you're seeing up there is $1.2 million. So if we're able to fund the program now without that heavy maintenance, we can take care of lots more lane miles is basically what it shows there. And this next exhibit here shows it best. There's each one of those areas, and this is a little better scale, but you can see those captions there that, you know, the year 10, you know, we've got about $450,000 to spend that. So you add that up aggregately, and you're up at about $1.25 million. So if we were to, you know, add another $750,000 because we've cut the program short being safe, you can see we would clip off about another 3 years. So my point is, if you look at this particular color drawing, we're getting close to about the 5 or 6 year program that was really our original goal here 5 years ago. That $2 million originally, we said, you know, that's about the right tax amount. And we said in 5-6 years, we're really gonna have much better service level standard. And I would qualify tonight, go out there and look at our roads throughout, much higher service level standard. And that concentration to get that old core of the town up to better service level standard has been accomplished. And we're on a very good program now to get back to a, as we say, when you look at the colors there, we're at 5 or 6 years. And that's really the best, the pavement management, that's your best condition for pavement management, just about that right sweet spot to where you're doing a surface treatment about every 5-6 years. So big success. I've been happy as a staff member that we had a funding source in 2016. We've had you know, lots of input. If you recall from July, we've had lots of good craftsmen out there doing the road work and making it look as good as it does. And it's been a fun program. So we're at that point today to say, yes, a lot more investment can be made into stretching that dollar further.
Mr. Tarkowski?
Yes, Mayor and Council, this is an opportunity just to say thank you. 5 years ago, you trusted staff. You were concerned about the conditions of roads, and we indicated it was going to take a half-cent sales tax increase to accomplish $2 million a year to road maintenance. $1 million was going to the police department. and they used it to hire 8 additional officers, and we continue to pay those salaries, certainly, and they're accomplishing their missions. But Norm's crew has moved forward, and as directed by you, taking care of the street. So it's time to just say thank you. He's gotten it done and will continue to do that. And in addition to that, if you will recall, any revenue collected over and above the $3 million that was due to that half-cent sales tax increase was to be used to pay down our PSPRS debt, which we are on track to do it as we had indicated to you. It should be done by 2030. We will be debt-free with public safety retirement. So you have caused some very big policy issues to be taken care of. And so thank you very much.
Vice Mayor.
I'd just like to make a couple comments. One of the things that I've enjoyed the most serving on this council, we do the right thing in the tough times. We're sitting in a building that we did in really tough times. And we did the right thing because we saved many thousands of dollars of construction costs. And Norm, we've done the right thing again with providing the half-cent tax, but I just want to make this comment. Do you know how happy our citizens are going to be that no longer have heavy repair programs on their street? We are making happy citizens on top of everything else.
Yeah, Vice Mayor, if I could comment, I remember 5 years ago I made the comment, you know, you reach that cliff that if you don't make those small investments, you lose your whole investment. I akined it to changing oil in your car. Can you get by with 5,000 miles? Sure, it's not recommended, but ultimately you're going to lose that whole engine. And we've invested in our pavements. We're hearing the feedback. We're one of the few rural communities in Arizona that can say we've got a great transportation system. The funding source wasn't there at the Fed or the state level. We did it locally. We generated them, and I think our residents are happy. We have a much better service level standard. You know, I say with pride that my counterpart at ADOT doesn't have the funding source. You see our adjacent highways aren't near as good a service level shape because they don't have the revenue. And we get calls quite a bit, even on Highway 69. Boy, it's really rough and lots of problems. You didn't really do that much when you did that maintenance treatment. I said, well, that's the money they had. So you're seeing the fruits of the labor, so to speak, of 5 years of investment. The investment's there, a much better service level standard. And I believe our residents are giving us praise. Yes, that's an adequate use of those tax dollars, and that's what we wanted. And we were able to deliver it with their input.
Anything else for Mr. Davis? Great presentation, as always, Norm.
Thank you.
That being said, folks, have a great night.